End of Jaraasandha. One day, a strange messenger made his appearance in the Darbar and presented an appeal to Sri Krishna on behalf of the kings and princes, numbering over 20,000, who were kept as prisoners by Jaraasandha at Girivrajapura. They prayed to Krishna for mercy and release, as they found none else who could save them. Just then, Devarishi Narada appeared in the court. Sri Krishna duly worshipped him and gave him a seat of honor and inquired about the Pandavas and their intentions. The sage replied, "O Lord, your Maya is incomprehensible. I've had enough and more of its taste. The Pandavas are also under the influence of your Maya. Even though they are enjoying supreme pleasures as kings, yet they want to perform a Rajasuya Yaga and further to worship you on that occasion. So be pleased to graciously accept their request." The assembled subjects were anxious that Jaraasandha should be put down first and Rajasuya Yaga could be attended later. Sri Krishna requested Uddhava to give his elderly advice in the matter. Uddhava heard the Devarishi's words, the counselor's opinion, and Sri Krishna's request, and spoke these words of wisdom as his opinion. "O Lord, you have no doubt to concede in cooperating with the Pandavas for performing the Rajasuya Yaga successfully. For performing that sacrifice, Jaraasandha is a great obstruction. Without destroying him, the Yaga cannot be conducted. He is a man of great strength. He cannot be won in a pitched battle. He can be won only by your grace, through Bhima in a dual combat. He is a devotee of Brahmins. Bhima should go to him in the guise of a Brahmin and ask for Bhiksha. The Bhiksha to give a hand-to-hand fight, which he would readily grant. Thus, both purposes would be gained by your accepting to cooperate in the Rajasuya Yaga." Sri Krishna and sage Narada accepted the faultless advice of Uddhava to be full of reason. All the elders gave their approval to the same. The whole of Dwaraka was on the move to Indraprasthapura. Sage Narada took leave and Sri Krishna sent back the messenger with the promise that the kings would be liberated very soon. Sri Krishna and the whole party reached Indraprastha after a pretty long journey. They were received outside the city by Yudhishthira and his brothers and taken with great pomp and honor. After entering the palace, Sri Krishna saluted Kunti. He was saluted by Draupadi and his sister Subhadra. Draupadi attended on all the consorts of Sri Krishna and they were provided with suitable lodgings. One day, Yudhishthira formally conveyed his desire to perform the Rajasuya Yaga to Sri Krishna and prayed for his blessings. Sri Krishna expressed his approval and blessed him to be successful. As a first step, Yudhishthira had to obtain the approval of all the kings in the world or win over in battle those who opposed him. Accordingly, Sahadeva was sent to the south, Nakula to the west, Arjuna to the north, and Bhima to the east. All of them went with big armies and returned victorious with great treasures. There was only one king, Jaraasandha, who would not yield to Yudhishthira. Yudhishthira was much depressed over this. Sri Krishna explained the secret plan advised by Uddhava and it was approved for execution. Bhima, Arjuna and Sri Krishna put on the garb of Brahmins and reached Girivrajapura and entered the palace through the gate allotted for Brahmins at a very suitable hour and asked Jaraasandha for Bhiksha and added that they had come from long distance to receive his benevolent gift. Jaraasandha understood that they were no mere Brahmins, might be some gods come to test him, and he readily promised to grant their request. Sri Krishna then revealed their identity and asked for the gift of a dual fight. Jaraasandha had a hearty laugh at their cunning and selected Bhima for his match. They went outside the city and began to fight with huge maces. The fight went on for 21 days. Bhima was not able to take the life out of Jaraasandha. Sri Krishna showed him how to kill Jaraasandha by slitting a twig into two by its length. Bhima understood the meaning. He caught hold of Jaraasandha, threw him on the ground, pressed one of his legs with his own leg, and tore off the other leg, making the body rent into two pieces along its length, from anus to the head, and threw the two pieces apart. Jaraasandha was dead. Sri Krishna entered the palace of Girivrajapura, installed Sahadeva, son of Jaraasandha, on the throne and released all the kings and princes kept in prison by Jaraasandha. They began to praise Sri Krishna. They further said, "It was out of our good luck that we were imprisoned. We are now devoid of our greed and power. We have become low and humble. It is all your grace. Now we are having the great privilege of having your darshan. We pray, show us the way to liberation. We no more want kingdom or power." Sri Krishna advised them to cultivate devotion to him and to live the remaining span of life allotted to them without attachment for objects. Rule their kingdoms, beget children, but have their mind always on him, and they would reach him in the end. They were all given nice bath, grand dress, and sumptuous food. They were provided with chariots to reach their capitals. They saluted Sri Krishna, had a good darshan of him again, and took leave of him. Sri Krishna was duly honored by Sahadeva, son of Jaraasandha, with large presents and great wealth, and they returned to Indraprastha. Yudhishthira was highly pleased with the fall of Jaraasandha and praised Sri Krishna as the supreme, born to destroy the wicked and protect the good and establish righteousness. It was all a sport for him. He dispels the feeling of I and mine in his devotees and makes them his equals. Rajasuya Yaga. With the permission of Sri Krishna, Yudhishthira resolved to perform the Rajasuya Yaga. He invited all the rishis, maharishis, devarishis, among whom were Krishna Dvaipayana, Vyasa, Bharadvaja, Vishwamitra, Jaimini, Parashara, Vaishampayana, Kashyapa, Parasurama, Shukracharya. He invited Bhishma, Drona and Kripa Acharyas, Dhritarashtra and his sons, Vidura and many other kings and princes, ministers, officers, Brahmins, Kshatriyas, Vaishyas and Sudras to Indraprasthapura. The sacrificial Yajnashala was duly ploughed, decorated and perfected. Gold vessels were made for the sacrifice. Brahma, Rudra, Indra, Siddhas, Sadhyas, Gandharvas, Charanas, Nagas, Yakshas, Rakshasas, Kinnaras, many kings and queens assembled there. Everybody declared that Yudhishthira was more fitted to perform the Rajasuya Yaga and expressed their approval. The sacrifice commenced. Soma juice was extracted. The sacrifice was almost completed. Then there arose the question as whom to honor as the most worthy personage in the whole assembly. There was a lot of discussion. Many expressed their opinions. Finally, Sahadeva, the youngest of the Pandavas, addressed the assembly. He said, "I consider Bhagavan Sri Krishna, the crown jewel of the Yadavas, to deserve the honor of primary worship in this assembly. For he is all the five elements, the sun, moon, the gods, fire, space and time. The whole universe is his manifestation. He is knowledge and action. He creates, sustains and destroys the universe by his yoga maya. By his grace, people obtain dharma, artha, kama and moksha. If we honor him, we will be honoring every living being and the supreme as well. All the people were pleased with Sahadeva's views and applauded him. Accordingly, King Yudhishthira offered worship to Sri Krishna as the first person of honor in the whole assembly. Yudhishthira and Draupadi washed the sacred feet of Sri Krishna. They gave him fine clothes and ornaments. Both of them saluted him. Then everybody followed their example and saluted Sri Krishna by word and action. Flowers rained on him from the heavens. Shishupala was the son of Satvali, sister of Vasudeva. He was the ruler of Chedi Desha. He was also present in the assembly. He was enraged at the words of Sahadeva and his views. He began to speak ill of Sri Krishna. He went on saying, "The young boy Sahadeva has prattled some words which have no meaning. A mere boy's words cannot be taken as final. In this assembly there are great sages, Maharishis and Devarishis, sages who are established in Brahman and they are adored even by gods. How can a cowherd boy who has no character, no varna, no ashrama, nor nobility of birth be considered as great? He is beyond dharma. He sets at naught all Vedic injunctions. His clan is addicted to drink. He does not live with ordinary people. He hides himself beyond the sea in the secluded Dwaraka, where Brahmins have no access." Thus, he went on painting a dark picture of Sri Krishna. With those foul words, all his merits were completely exhausted. Sri Krishna did not speak a word of protest till he had completed. Those words were felt to be unbearable by the whole audience. Some closed their ears and left the hall, because he who hears vilification of God or his devotees and does not protest and leave the place loses all his merits and goes to hell. Many kings stood up with their swords drawn out to attack Shishupala. Shishupala retorted. Observing the delicate situation, Sri Krishna stood up and pacified all the kings. Then he sent his Sudarshana Chakra, which severed the head of Shishupala amidst the acclamations of all the people. Shishupala's friends ran pell-mell. The whole assembly could see a flame of light emanate from the body of Shishupala and enter the sacred body of Sri Krishna. Shishupala was one of the two gatekeepers of Vaikuntha, Jaya and Vijaya, cursed by the sages, who by intense hatred always remembered the Lord and thereby obtained salvation. This was his third and final birth, and there was no more of his coming back to samsara, and so he had merged with the Supreme. Yudhishthira concluded the sacrifice by giving large presents and feasts to the priests. He had the Avadbrita Snana and after the successful completion of the Rajasuya Yaga. All the sages, gods and celestials returned back much pleased with the sacrifice. Sri Krishna remained there for several months with all his consorts, spending the time with Yudhishthira in peace and joy. Duryodhana also remained for a long time, but he was the only person who could not have peace of heart on seeing the splendor and glory of the Pandavas and their fortune. Parikshit inquired, "O sage, when everybody, including gods, sages and celestials, were pleased with the Rajasuya Yaga, how was it that Duryodhana alone was much unhappy about it?" Sage Shuka replied, "When the relations arrived for the sacrifice, each of them had, by mutual agreement, taken up some duty or other. Thus, Bhima was in charge of the kitchen. Duryodhana was in charge of the treasury. Sahadeva was in charge of reception of guests. Nakula took up procurement of supplies. Arjuna was deputed for service to elders. Sri Krishna undertook to wash the feet of guests. Draupadi looked after catering. Karna looked after bestowing presents. Similarly, others were also engaged and all of them discharged their duties to the satisfaction of Yudhishthira. Duryodhana saw the great treasures of the Pandavas, which was a collection of the treasures of all the kings in the world. the demon kings, the treasures of celestial lords, all put together and mostly collected by the demon engineer called Maya. He saw the splendor of the palaces of the Pandavas, the ascending glory of Yudhishthira after the Rajasuya Yaga. He could not have peace at heart. Further, one day, long after the sacrifice, Yudhishthira was sitting in one of the courts in the magic palace attended by his brothers, Sri Krishna, Draupadi and others. Duryodhana also entered the hall. He had already a quarrel with the doorkeepers. With an angry mind, he entered the hall, mistook plain floor for water and drew up his clothes. And after the next few steps, fell into a pit of water which appeared to be plain floor. The yoga maya of Sri Krishna started to play. Draupadi and Bhima and others began to laugh at him. Yudhishthira, however, resented their action. But Sri Krishna kept quiet, knowing full well that the major work of his avatara was yet to be accomplished and the seed sowing for it was just being accomplished. Duryodhana was confused and humiliated. He left Indraprastha immediately for Hastinapura with a sore heart. Salva, King Salva was one of the friends of Sishupala. He had attended the Swayamvara of Rukmini, where he was badly beaten along with Sishupala. After Sishupala's death, he took a vow to destroy the Yadavas. He performed tapas in praise of Lord Shiva and obtained an aerial car which could travel as per the wish of the owner. With that car, he marched on Dwaraka. Sri Krishna and Balarama were at Indraprastha. Prince Pradyumna with his brothers met Salva and gave him a great battle. Once Pradyumna was badly hit and lies wound. Meanwhile, Sri Krishna and Balarama, suspecting foul play at home, returned to Dwaraka. Sri Krishna attacked Salva, destroyed his aerial car and killed him with his Sudarshana Chakra. Dantavaktra was a cousin of Sri Krishna, son of Shruta Devi, sister of Vasudeva. He was a great friend of Sishupala. He was the incarnation of Vijaya and the other gatekeeper of Vaikuntha. This was his last and third birth. He wanted to take vengeance on Sri Krishna for killing his friends Sishupala, Salva, Paundraka, etc. Sri Krishna killed him with his mace called Kaumodika. A pale flame of light emanated from his body and entered the body of Sri Krishna, signifying his return to his original abode. Dantavaktra's brother Viduraka was also killed by Sri Krishna. Balarama. Time passed on. Balarama heard that the Kauravas were making preparations for a war against the Pandavas. He decided to remain neutral and avoid the battle and so left Dwaraka on a pilgrimage. While visiting sacred places, he came to Naimisharanya. There he saw an assembly of sages hearing sacred discourses. On his approach, the whole assembly stood up in his honor and saluted him as the avatara of Adisesha. The preceptor in the assembly was a Sutta. Though of a lower caste, having been given the seat of a guru, he did not get up along with the assembly. Balarama mistook him to be proud and disrespectful and filled his head with the end of a kusha grass. The whole assembly raised a cry of horror and appraised Balarama that he had committed an act equivalent to killing a Brahmin, as the Sutta was given the exalted place by their choice. Balarama felt sorry for his hasty action. He said that the Sutta's son would take up his place and that the discourse would continue uninterrupted. He wanted to know from them whether he could do anything more as amends for his sin. The rishis requested him to destroy the demon called Balvala, who was causing great harm to them. Balarama waited there till the full moon. The demon made his appearance on the full moon day and began to rain filth over the area. Balarama invoked his weapons, the plough and the pestle, caught Balvala by the plough and gave him blows with his pestle, and the demon fell down dead, vomiting blood. The rishis were much pleased with Balarama and advised him to continue his pilgrimage by visiting all the sacred places for 1 year and to return safely. Accordingly, Balarama visited the four corners of Bharatavarsha and returned after 1 year. On the way, he heard from some Brahmins that all the Kauravas and Pandavas were destroyed in the battle. He hastily repaired to Kurukshetra and reached there on the last day of the battle when Bhima and Duryodhana were having the duel fight with maces. Balarama advised them to cease fighting because both were equals. His advice fell on deaf ears. So he immediately left the place for Dwaraka via Naimisharanya, where he met the sages again and imparted to them the knowledge of the self, because he was Adisesha himself.